Hello everyone, welcome to the TriStar Gym channel. Hopefully you guys hear me loud and clear. Give me that thumbs up. Let me know that you can hear me loud and clear. Salam Zaki. Hello everyone. Yes, yes, yes. Hello. Hopefully you hear me loud and clear. Sounds good. Beautiful. Thank you, Brandon. Thank you, Zeke. Thank you, Zaki. James Gill, you guys hear me? Thank you very much for letting me know. You guys know me about the sound. I always forget a button or two, but luckily today I got it again on the first try. Looking forward to my button pushing purple belt. I know I had it once, lost it. Hope to get it back again. And today I didn't prepare a topic today, guys, because I'm kind of doing this at the last minute, but I'm sure we're going to have an incredible episode as usual. I did watch your crazy American elections, you crazy Americans and your amazing elections. There's reality TV, and then there's the American politics, American election day. What an incredible couple of days. Checking the count. Oh my God, I'm telling you. In Canada, we're more interested in American politics than we are in Canadian politics. It's just it's a special time now in American politics. It's just it's hard not to watch. Just really hard not to watch. And I saw that King Trump was now defeated in the election, which I got to be honest, I wasn't sure if he was going to win or not. You know, so many people, I don't trust the polls. I don't think anybody trusts the polls anymore. And it was looking good for him at one point. Then the next day we woke up and we see Biden. Biden is ahead. And of course, a lot of people saying it was fraud. Not a lot of people, but a certain, you know, Trump and his crew screaming fraud, foul play. But that was probably the most interesting fight I saw all week. Biden versus Trump. That was the biggest fight. Other than that, guys, I wanted to keep it to a AMA. Ask me anything. Somebody pick an interesting topic. We already have that Indian dude has asked a question already. He already sent in a super chat. Indian dude says, hey coach, do you see future Iranian MMA fighters? They have stellar grapplers. My friend, Mr. Indian dude. Yes, I have several in my gym already. They're phenomenal wrestlers and we are now molding them into MMA fighters. So look out for that very soon. Trump wasn't robbed. That's from AS. Well, you know, I don't want to stick my nose where it doesn't belong, but I also think it wasn't. And I actually looked into it. I was interested to see, you know, what are his claims. It seems like all his claims are very, very, how should I say? They're very weak, you know. There's never been a perfect election. I guarantee you that every election has some margin of error, you know. Somebody did some illegal vote and somebody did, you know, maybe somebody was registered in two states and that's illegal. Well, actually, voting in two states, in both states is illegal. You can only vote in one. It's not illegal to be registered in two states from what I read. And it seems that this election was well within the norm of miscounts or, you know, let's say error, human error, or even somebody trying to cheat. It's well within the margin of error. And even if they corrected it, it probably add up for more Biden votes than Trump votes. But again, unless Trump can show some evidence, his team can show some evidence for some kind of serious, and it's not impossible. Okay, I don't want to sit here and say it's impossible. I'm not saying that at all. I mean, I wasn't there. I'm not involved, obviously, in the process. But unless they can prove somebody made some kind of serious, somebody really tinkered around with the votes, he's gonna end up losing. You know, he has lost already. They've called it. You know, unless some new, that's what he would need. He would need some kind of new evidence to pop up, because right now, from what I read, his evidence is extremely weak. But again, it hasn't been certified yet, so I'm waiting like everybody else. Have you ever had two people off the street settle their conflict in a fight under your supervision at TriStar? That's from DBJMK. As a matter of fact, my friend, I have. Let me tell you a story in TriStar Gym. Once upon a time, a long, long time ago, long in a galaxy far, far away, there was a place maybe called TriStar, maybe not. And we were working out late, and this is a long, long time ago in a universe far, far away. These two guys walked in and they were followed by a camera. And they walked up to us. We were finished. It was the end of the day. Like, it was the end of the night, and we were done training. Everybody was spent, and we're wrapping up. We're about to leave. These guys walk in with a camera. And they're asking us, hey, could you guys stick around to corner these guys? These guys are about to mix it up. They're going to spar. We're like, nah, honestly, it's late. We're all leaving. Everybody had plans. Everybody was out the door almost. And then the camera started rolling, and these guys started talking about their issues they had at work. These guys had a legitimate beef between one another. Listen, these guys had a legitimate beef. These guys wanted to settle their beef. And we were, you know, overhearing the story, and we got intrigued. You know, one guy was in the office, and I can't remember what happened, but these guys legitimately didn't like each other. So me and my other friends, you know, other professional fighters and trainers and whatnot, were listening. We're like, you know what? We'll stick around. We'll want to see how this works out, actually. We're quite interested. So they glove up, they gear up, full gear, and they start fighting. Now, I didn't know if these guys had any skill, but after a minute, I was, you know, I could tell these guys had no skill, but they hated each other. They had such a distaste for one another. They were fighting hard. Like, I'm telling you, like, it was a Rocky Five here, Rocky Four. And they were punching each other, knocking each other down. It was just a crazy fight. No skill, just an incredible amount of distaste for one another. Anyways, long story short, they beat each other up. We supervised it. We didn't let it get out of hand. And it wasn't really a winner. They both gave some, took some, gave some. And at the end, they had squashed their beef, which is what I like. They had squashed it. And they got out of their system. You know, they said their, you know, they said their piece, and it was settled. But that was a legitimate fight with equipment, though. Obviously, you know, we wouldn't let them do it the bare knuckle. But they actually had the brains to do it in a gym with equipment instead of out there in the street. So in the streets, no. I can't really tell you about those stories, but it has. I can't say it hasn't happened. There has been some fights outside of TriStar, out of my control. I can't say much about it, but in the gym, we've settled it in a humane way, which gave me an incredible idea for a show. And I had this idea for a reality show. Two guys. I thought of this like 10 years later. I'm like, you know what? Remember that time I was telling the guys in the gym, remember that time when those two guys had that beef and they came in the gym and they fought each other? And I was like, you know what? We should do that. We should do that. We should have guys who want to settle their score with rules, with gloves, with headgear, and a week of training. And I actually shot a pilot. I don't know if I should show it to you guys. I actually shot a pilot with me, George St. Pierre, the whole crew, the whole gym. It was pretty awesome, actually, but it would take me a few minutes to dig it up. Give me a thumbs up if you want me to dig it up. If not, I'll just let it be. Let me see if I can find it here. It's a pretty amazing pilot. Give me a thumbs up if you guys want to see this. I got it right here, ladies and gentlemen. Am I getting enough thumbs up? I need a thumbs up. I need 100 likes. Give me 100 likes. Not thumbs up on the chat, gentlemen. Give me 100 likes. I got to open up my email to get it. Oh, boy. Here we go. What did I do for you guys? Guys, stick around. You're going to love this. Give me a thumbs up. Give me a like on this video, guys. If you give me a like on this video, if I get 100 likes on this video, I'm going to open up this thing. I'm probably going to get sued for showing you guys this. Guys, I had it done by a professional network. Like, I'm telling you, this is like primo. I'm not talking about Mickey Mouse filming here. It wasn't done with an iPhone. I'm talking about Hollywood quality here. Hollywood quality. You guys want to see two guys with beef? I'm going to show you two guys with beef. Guys, put a like on the video, not in the chat room. Gentlemen, I need enough likes in the chat room. All right, let me see here. Guys, it's going to take me a little bit to set it up. Be patient. I have it here before my eyes. Where is my... I hope this link still works. Give me a minute, guys. I'm going to show you something incredibly entertaining. When I say incredibly entertaining, I will not disappoint you. All right, here it is. It's coming up. I just emailed it to my other account that I opened here. Here it is. I wanted to call it Got Beef, and the network wanted to call it Settle the Beef. Isn't that crazy? I was like, guys, it can't be called Settle the Beef. Hold on. Hold on a second. Do you guys hear that? Do you guys hear this? Hold on. I'm gonna put it on screen. Don't worry. Give me a second here. Okay, I'm going to put it on screen. Give me a second here, gentlemen. Give me a second here. Let me see what I got going here. How on earth? Hold on a second. Screen capture. Okay. All right, I got it. The hooks are in. The hooks are in, gentlemen. You guys are about to watch this. I am about 3 minutes, 1 minute away. 1 minute away from presenting it to you. Give me 1 minute and you're going to be watching Got Beef. All right, gentlemen, as promised. Voila. All right, this is Got Beef. Enjoy.
Everyone has had at least one beef in their life. That one time that someone did something to you that you just can't forget. What if you were given the opportunity to settle things once and for all?
George St. Pierre presents Got Beef, the unprecedented format that gives everyday people the opportunity to train like MMA champions and resolve their beef in the ultimate face-to-face battle that could win them a cash prize of $10,000 and the honor of settling their conflict once and for all.
$10,000.
The contenders will leave their family, friends, and daily life behind for an intensive 7-day training at Montreal's world-renowned TriStar Gym. Completely submerged into the mixed martial arts subculture, the two rivals will live opposite to one another in one of two.
Okay, guys, I'm not sure how well you can hear this, but these two guys basically are living in the TriStar dorms for 1 week. They have a beef with one another. You're going to hear about their beef now. One lives in the east side building, one lives in the west side building.
Dormitories alongside other contenders and actual UFC fighters in training.
Hey, better pick a room quick.
Okay.
This is Christoph's room. This is where he stays. Been cooking this clean spot here. There's a toilet here. Take your ones and twos in there.
Oh my god.
Yo, it's worse than college dorms. It's the shittiest place on earth.
I'll be spending a lot of time at the gym.
Hey, put your clothes back on.
Do you know what they need in here? A woman. Or maybe four. I met Leah and Jonathan about 3 years ago. At the time, I didn't even know Mueller. They had just broken up. I didn't even hear about him until he stopped paying alimony for Jonathan.
She wanted to have a kid. She put some pressure on me. Things weren't going that well.
There's fights on the phone, Mueller disappearing.
Things are tight on my end. I have a hard time paying my rent, you know?
This guy, he's a coward who runs away from his problems.
This fucking guy, he's gonna tell me how to run my fucking family?
Maybe a couple hits in the face will make him realize that he has to be a real dad.
Each contender will be matched and trained with one of two internationally acclaimed coaches, Firas Zahabi and Mark Della Grotte. Both who have trained the best mixed martial arts fighters and produced some of the top UFC title holders.
I don't sugarcoat shit.
Fighting is serious business.
I can't believe I'm training with Firas.
Come on over, apprentice.
I can't wait to meet JSP. Yeah, I'm a big fan.
My man Mueller. I don't actually agree with him not paying child support. We call that in Boston deadbeat dad.
But you look fat, man.
Take off your shirt. Take off your shirt.
Oh, I thought he was really out of shape. You know, you look at his body, he's flabby, he's soft.
done a bit of boxing here and there.
Tough guy with tattoos, beats up the chubby kid. Seen this movie many a times.
You're here to fight? We're here to train. You're going to waste our time?
No.
Don't waste our fucking time.
Of course, I have a very different coaching style than Mark DeLagrotti.
You willing to do the work this week or what?
Yep.
He's more calm. He's more composed.
My name's on the line too, bro.
I personally like to cut to the core right away. What are you made of? How do you react under pressure? Because let's not waste anybody's time.
Each coach will evaluate their apprentice and devise a training plan that will provide them with the tools that they will need to crush their opponent.
My training plan is giving him the basic tools, both offensively and defensively.
My contender doesn't know anything about kicking or punching.
What the fuck, man?
The only thing he's really got going for him is heart. So it's gonna be mental strength versus physical strength.
Hey, coach, how do you think I'm doing?
This fucking guy. It's day one, bro. Slow down. All right? A lot of people think they're a tough guy, but it all changes when you see the sparkles and you feel like you drank a fucking 12-pack.
Come on, just never show you're tired. Never show you're tired.
That was the hardest thing I've ever done in my whole life. No words. I'm still shaking.
Let's go. Don't fail on me. Let's go.
You all right?
Yeah.
The same methods used on professional fighters will be used on the contenders to test their limits and prepare for the week to come.
We dunk the contenders in ice because we want to see who's mentally strong.
Don't let this fat kid beat you.
They're eye to eye, they're face to face, just like they're going to be on fight night.
He's failing, kid. Hang in there, he's falling off.
You know, in a fight, you don't feel the pain that they're in. That guy's living something very different than you are, sitting on your couch, eating candy canes and drinking cola.
Muller's dead. You hear me, Muller? $10,000 is mine.
Fucking embarrassment. Get out of here.
With their eyes on the prize, the coaches have five more days to transform their contenders into fighting machines.
Stop moving that fucking foot.
I'm surprised how hard it actually is. I thought it would be a little bit easier.
I think when he came in, he was a little bit cocky, and he understood the reality of fighting.
Tired today, huh?
This is fucking hard, man. Dude, I feel like I've already been into the fight.
Now that's a problem.
You gotta have that tough mental strength, or else you're just gonna cave in. You're gonna hesitate, you're gonna panic, you're gonna run.
As exhaustion, pain, fear, and anxiety kick in, the journey...
Okay, I don't know if you guys are liking this, but let me know if you guys want to see the rest of it. Because it's a few more minutes long. The guys don't actually end up fighting. This was the pilot to see if we would be able to film it. And unfortunately, we never filmed an entire episode. Hold on a second. Let me see. I can cut this. Did you guys want to see the rest? I think that's enough. So anyways, these two guys, they train with us for a week. And the winner gets $10,000. That was the pilot to see if any network wanted to buy it. And unfortunately, nobody picked it up. Can you believe it? We had GSP, DeLagrotti, myself, two guys with beef, actual story, this and that. Let's get into. Well, we didn't ever have them fight, guys. Don't ask. No, don't ask who won. They didn't actually fight. We never filmed the episode. That was just a pilot. Tell us who won. They did not fight. Those two individuals did not fight. No, it's not a. You guys want me to play it? Okay, I'm gonna play it just because I'm getting a lot of people asking me to play it here. No problem. I'm happy to play for you guys. Give me one sec here. Hold on one second here, gentlemen.
Towards the final battle will prove to be... The hardest personal struggle any contender could face.
Hey, babe, how are you?
No,
I've had a rough day.
I don't think I've ever pushed myself this far, man.
I don't know if I can do this, to be honest. I really don't know. Would you hate me if I just came home?
There's many a times that you want to quit, but you know you have to dig down deep inside. And that human fight for survival is what keeps us in the fight. But look at how far you've come now, man. Come on, let's get it together here. Let's get through this, bro. You got this. Come on.
together with his role as the main commentator for the final fight, GSP will also act as mentor to the two opponents, providing a fighter's point of view of the challenges to come.
Who are you going up against?
My ex-girlfriend, new boyfriend.
Really?
Yeah.
You don't like him, man?
No, he's
George good. Loves beef,
oh,
guys.
Really? Yeah. Nice. Show me what you got. Stop. When you hit that bag, it's like an opponent. You have to be at the end of your punches when you hit the bag.
Punch?
An elbow when you get inside. It can cause a lot more damage.
In mixed martial arts, it's a very humbling experience. You can't start and be good right away. Maybe they're not humble in real life, but they will learn a big lesson here by coming here and doing this.
Why you don't like him?
He's not paying child support.
Oh, okay. Yes. He's more bigger. Really? And it's him who challenged the other guy, right? Jordan seems to be like...
Guys, let me tell you something about George, okay? He loves beef. Look at him. He's smiling. He's enjoying this. He's like, oh, this guy, what happened? He doesn't know what their beef is. He's like, I'm like, he won't pay child support. And this guy's here to collect. He challenged him on the show. He wants to collect. And look at George. He's loving it. Look at him.
Like, he wanted a little bit more. He got more passion into it.
To your left. That's it. Good job, Jordan.
I see huge improvements. You know, some people are stubborn. They think they know it all.
Looking good, huh? Looking good. Much better.
You know, it's kind of the guy that walked into the gym, but it's not the guy that I see now in front of me.
I feel it.
You have to be patient, yeah? Oh, that one was not bad. The second one was the one you were more flat. Watch it again. Visualize it. And do it.
I'm feeling great. And I can't even think. I've been so tired.
Yeah, I'm feeling confident. I'm going to win that $10,000.
Thanks. With the ultimate battle looming, the coaches' jobs are done, and the rivals are left to hone their newly learned skills and prepare for the fight to come.
These 3 minutes are going to be the most important in my entire life.
I have nothing to lose, everything to win.
Let's see who wants it more. He's about to get the biggest reality check of his life.
In front of family and friends, the two rivals will face down in an authentic cage match. Only one will take home the $10,000 cash prize and the bragging rights to settling their beef.
Fighting is a scary thing. People have no idea. Everybody says they want to fight until fight night comes around.
And that's it, gentlemen. That was the pilot for Got Beef. Never got picked up. Can you believe it? I really thought people were going to enjoy this. Hold on a second. Let me click this off here. Boom. Look at these button pushing skills. Look at this. How you say I'm not a purple belt yet? Look at this. Button pushing this. All right, guys. What did you think? Give me a thumbs up if you thought it was cool. Give me a thumbs down if you thought it was boring and you would never watch this kind of thing. Let me know. Give me a thumbs up or a thumbs down. Don't be shy. Give me a thumbs up in the chat room now I'm talking about. Let me see here. Let me give you a visual here. Give me a thumbs up or a thumbs down here. Let me know. Who would win if they fought? I hate to say it. I think the bad guy. I think the guy who's not paying child support. Thumbs up, thumbs up, thumbs up. One thumb down. That's not bad. That's not bad. That's good. That's good. Yeah, I think the bad guy in the story was the tougher one. Like physically, he could punch harder. You could tell he had boxed a little bit, very little. But the guy I had, Jordan, my God, he knew nothing. Like he knew nothing. He didn't know how to make a fist. It was scary. You know, I was trying to teach him very little because he knows very little. There's very little to work with. I just wanted to, thank you, Amira. I wanted to get him in shape and kind of just teach him the most basic, like how to keep his chin down, his hands up, how to throw a punch, how to sprawl or pummel for an underhook. Basically, the most basic, like literally, I didn't want to confuse him because he's just going to panic on fight night. And I didn't want to try to get him in shape because he'll just be sore on fight night. I just wanted to give him a basic, very basic feel of what fighting is like so he's not too overtaken on fight night. Glad to see a lot of you guys would have enjoyed it, but unfortunately did not get picked up. I thought it would have been great, you know, get two guys with their story or why they want to fight each other and we do it in a safe environment. You know, obviously we don't want anybody to get hurt. It would have been like big glove sparring, one round of 3 minutes. And they're probably getting fall in love with the sport at the end of the day. You know, it's probably going to be something they're gonna want to do for a long time. Amira A, thank you again. Merci beaucoup. Love your t-shirt for us. Yes, guys, listen, I got this awesome shirt. Strike hard, strike first, strike hard. No mercy. This is from my friend Steve Claveau. Shout out to Steve Claveau for getting me this shirt. He bought me this shirt, gave it to me as a little surprise. Love this shirt. You know I love
T-shirts, guys. You know, it's my thing. I love to wear a nice shirt. And I absolutely love this one. Cobra Kai, my friends. I never thought I'd wear a Cobra Kai shirt. You know, I'm more of a Miyagi guy myself, more of a Daniel-san fan. But I respect the Cobra Kai. Respect. And I love this shirt. Absolutely love it. Okay, guys, let's open it up. Guys, by the way, that show would never have picked up. You guys asked me when you can audition. There's no show. There's no show. I might maybe in the future try it again. Who knows? But as of now, that show is not happening. For us, what is your favorite movie of all time? That's from Tahir. My favorite movie of all time. You guys are probably wondering, martial arts movie, right? Or No Holds Barred. Let me give you both. My favorite movie of all time. Martial arts movie of all time. Fighting movie of all time. Fighting movie of all time would probably be Rocky IV. Rocky IV probably is my favorite movie of... Rocky IV Kumite. Jean-Claude Van Damme's Kumite, guys. I can't decide. Rocky IV Kumite. I don't know. Favorite movie of all time, like Hollywood movie. Yeah, that's probably what you were asking me. Hollywood movie of all time, I would say... Wow, that's a tough one. Very difficult one to say, but I really love. There's, I have too many favorites. The Count of Monte Cristo. The Count of Monte Cristo, Fight Club. Even though when it first came out, I thought it was about fighting. I didn't want to see the movie. Then when I actually watched it, I was like, okay, it didn't have nothing to do with fighting, and had actually a lot to do with a lot of interesting ideas that actually have a background in philosophy. So I thought it was I was very happily surprised with Fight Club. What else? I love The Matrix, the first two, let's say. Batman trilogy, AS. No, not really. I wasn't too big into Batman. I think they're cool, but I wouldn't say it's my favorite by far. It's not one of my favorites at all. There's another movie with the actor Ken Norton, The Illusionist, I believe it's called, where he's a magician. I forget the name of that movie. An amazing movie. Shutter Island. I love that movie with DiCaprio. Shutter Island. If you guys never saw that one, you must watch that movie. It's a great movie. But remind me, what was that movie with the guy from Fight Club? I think his name is Ken Norton. And he was in a movie, Edward Norton. Thank you. Thank you. I'm very bad with actors. The only reason I know his name is because he actually shot a scene in TriStar Gym. So one time they came in, they rented the TriStar Gym for 3 days. They redid TriStar Gym. Like, they rebuilt the scene inside. Like, you couldn't tell it's the TriStar Gym. And they're like, Edward Norton is coming. I didn't know who it was, but then they were telling me it's the guy from Fight Club. The Illusionist. That's one of my favorite movies of all time. Love that movie. Okay, so those are some of my favorite movies. I have too many. I know later I'm going to think of other ones that I should have mentioned. There's just too many great movies. Okay, what else we got here? Felder versus RDA. Guys, that is an exciting fight. RDA was supposed to fight Islam Makhachev. That fight fell through. Islam is not able to do the fight. Paul Felder steps in. What a fight, man. This is going to be just as exciting. Who's going to win that fight? That is really hard to call. Okay, here's my thing. RDA is doing 155 again. That's not easy. Like, he's been at 170. He's let his body go. How hard is that cut going to be? Well, you know what? He's done it for so many years. I believe he can do it. I'm not worried about it. It's just how is his body going to feel after he let himself go, got comfortable at 170. We've seen it so many times. The guy moves up in weight, tries to go back down, doesn't have the same success. We've seen it many times. It's difficult to put your body back where it used to be after you've let it kind of like morph a bit. Okay, that's one thing I heavily question. Standing, I'm going to give an edge to Felder. On the ground, I'm going to give an edge to RDA, but there's this X factor. I'm just not sure how RDA is going to look. But RDA is more well-rounded, while Felder, in my opinion, is going to be... he's going to have an edge in the striking. I think that in the later rounds, Felder's just going to stand strong. It's going to be more durable. Because I think it's going to be difficult for RDA to fit himself back into 155. I don't know why. I have this creeping doubt that he let himself go. He got a little bit bigger. And now making that 155, it's going to hurt. The later rounds are going to hurt. But then again, RDA has so much composure. He's so experienced. He can kind of relax and recover. But Felder's going to be all over him. So that's a very, very interesting fight. Very hard to call. I got to give this one a 50-50 just because it's so, there's such an X factor. When it came to Makhachev and RDA, I was going to give it to Makhachev. I thought Makhachev was just going to be a higher pace all night long. It was going to be tight, but Makhachev was going to run away from it because I just don't think that RDA can make that weight comfortably. With Felder, I think it's going to be a close, close fight, but I don't see Felder slowing down. I have a doubt if RDA can keep up with him. It's going to be interesting. Coach, what's your advice to overcome procrastination? That's from Nader Jalal. Nader Jalal, procrastination. Try to find things you're passionate in doing, and that way procrastination will kind of dissolve itself. If you're procrastinating, it's probably not the field you want to be in. Think about it. Think long and hard. Why are you procrastinating? You don't procrastinate to do things you love, right? So try to find a way to change your routine around so that your routine is done around things you really love. Now, let's say you have to study for a test and you're procrastinating and you have to get through this test to get to what you want. Visualize in your mind what's behind that test. And that's going to hopefully give you that motivation to get up. So if you're trying to become a lawyer or a doctor or whatever, an engineer, and you know, you're just procrastinating because you just don't want to go through these tests. You know, the studying part is kind of a drag. Just visualize yourself as a doctor, engineer. And you know, that's what you got to get through. It's on the other side. That reward is on the other side of that obstacle. It should motivate you. Motivation is huge, guys. You got to know how to push your buttons. You got to know how to deal with your mind. Okay? I love that old quote by Thomas Aquinas. He says, look, I tell my hand what to do and it does it. You know, my hand is a body part and it obeys command. Not the brain. The brain, I tell it what to do and it talks back to me. Like it pushes back. And there's this struggle because the brain is another organ, right? The hand is a organ, the limb, it's a limb, it's an organ. And how come this organ doesn't obey me? It seems to fight back. It seems to struggle for control. And I think it's a very wise thing that you got to learn to master and subdue this mind. And it's all about motivation. It's not always stick. Sometimes use carrot. Try to motivate yourself. Try to motivate that mind. Try to give it a picture. Try to entice it to want to do it, to get through. And remind it why it's going to want to get through this test. Why are we doing these daily chores? Why are we doing these daily things? But I can't do them for a long term. I gotta have a carrot at the end of the tunnel. If it's something I have to do forever, if you're telling me, hey, you gotta get up, but you gotta do this one thing you hate doing for the rest of your life, it's gonna be hard to get motivated. And I'm gonna procrastinate. But if it's just a short term and then I'm gonna get this great reward, that's a whole new way of looking at things. Hey, for us, I'm in Montreal. I'd like to... hold on. It's sliding on me. Hold on a second. Hello, for us. Oh, no. Hold on. Hey, for us, I'm in Montreal. I'd like to know when your gym is open. Do you train beginners, private lessons, type lessons? That's from Mike. Mike, I'm not currently doing any privates. The gym is officially closed. Only professional training at this time. So, unfortunately, there is no beginner training. It's just seasoned professionals that are getting ready for certain bouts. Hello, Faras. You talked about how current generation is weaker than previous generation. You mentioned Socrates talks about this, his three generation example. What book is this? That's for JR. JR, read The Republic from Plato. Read The Republic, okay? Check out the book, The Republic. For us, which is better, running or shadow kickboxing? If I had to pick one, I think they're both good. If I had to pick one, I'd pick shadow boxing. Okay. All right. Coach, what and how to train with a broken hand? That's from Alvaro. Alvaro, a lot of guys, what they do is they'll tape their hand to a tennis ball. You're talking about a broken finger? Because if you're in a broken hand and you got a cast, if you have a broken finger, usually what they do is they tape it around the tennis ball. And so that way it protects their finger. It's challenging. Be very careful. You don't want to make the break any worse. Usually it's a 2-week period, so just do everything else but sparring, you know, do fitness, do technique, but don't go live. I really don't recommend you go live. Are you going to do another BJJ versus striking video, coach, like the one with Gordon and Gary? That's from Limbertinder. Yes, in the future I will be doing that. Listen, I have so many creative ideas now that they've closed the gym. I'm just itching for them to open it back up and I can get going with that. But I am coming out with a new striking instructional, which is coming out very soon on jujuclub.com. Special thanks to timtam.tech. Guys, if you're getting a power massager, make sure to get one from the home team. The home team makes the world's best power massager. world's best power massager, and now we have this new adapter that fits on any massager. So if you have a competitor's massager, buy this power heated tip, universal heated tip. It's right there on your screen. It can fit on the Theragun, the Hyper Ice, and any gun, the old Tim Tam. You just get the adapter that goes with it. It's about $75, and now your gun has heat. It's a high-powered heat massager. Makes a total difference. And make sure to check out jujiclub.com. Don't forget to go to BJJ Fanatics and pick up my latest Guillotine Traps video. Okay, it's the best instructional I've filmed so far. Check it out. Guillotine. Control anybody with a guillotine. Make sure to get a copy, guys. Don't sleep on it. It's an amazing instructional. It's on BJJ Fanatics right now. Okay, what else we got here, gentlemen? We are in 36 minutes deep. I hope you guys are enjoying this. What's the best advice for an MMA fighter, a 21-year-old MMA fighter, in terms of training and recovery and experience? Hendav, you wrote that question 20 times, and it's a very general question, okay? So I'll just tell you, be consistent with your training. Instead of training hard 8 hours a day and then giving up for 3 weeks because your body is so beat up, your knee is broken, and you need the 4 weeks recovery, and then you're going to come back and try to muster that habit, you're going to try to go back to how deep you were in the game, and then now your other knee's broken, and 6 months down the line you have two injured knees and a bad neck. And don't overdo it, okay? I love, one of my favorite books of all time is First Things First by Stephen R. Covey. So it's in the Seven Habits, there's a section First Things First, but he also wrote a book called First Things First, and he talks about how everything has a season. You know, you plant a seed, and that seed, you can't expect it to grow the next day, and training is the same way. Find an adequate amount of training. Push the envelope as much as you can maintain without getting injured. That's the key, okay? So if you're training too little, you won't get any real gains. If you're training too hard, you're going to get injured. Find the right amount that your body can handle without breaking. And you can maintain a happy-go-lucky persona at the same time. You know, if you're grouchy all the time and you feel miserable, you might be overtraining, okay? Especially if you're not a professional, you shouldn't go that far. For us, are DVDs and videos a good way to learn, or are they useless if you don't learn from a teacher? Jason, that's from Jason. Jason, I recommend the two because your teacher doesn't know anything. Your teacher doesn't know everything, and I definitely don't know everything. So we need now to circulate that information, and then it becomes about how much you study. Okay, so, you know, instructional videos are very good, but you also need an instructor, I think, and a team. I never saw a guy get really good learning at home by himself on videos. Honestly, personally, I've just never seen it. Everybody I've seen who's really, really good, has a great trainer. They're very, you need these three things, okay? You need to have a great trainer, you need to be a great student, and even less, you need to have maybe some new information. You know, these instructional videos can be very helpful because your trainer doesn't know everything, and maybe that one thing that you learned from that instructional makes a whole difference on the mat, you know? But the two most important things is a great student and a great trainer. That's the ultimate combination. But again, more information sometimes is very good. Oftentimes is very good. Hey, Coach Zahabi, what's your specialty in coaching? Like, what are you best at? That's from El Presidente. El Presidente, well, I'll tell you something. I'm really, I'm deep in the whole game. So I'm deep into wrestling, I'm deep into jiu-jitsu, and I'm deep into striking. So I guess you would say I'm a general MMA coach, and I like to work with expert wrestlers, expert strikers, expert grapplers. But if I had to categorize myself, I would say I'm a general mixed martial artist. Hey, I wanted to ask you about polyphasical sleep, 6 hours and less. Do you think it has negative impact on abilities in combat sports? That's from Nadim. Listen, I really think you should get 8 hours. If you're training hard, you should get 8 hours. I don't know how old you are, but I know as you get older, they say you don't need as much sleep. But I really think 8 hours of sleep is very important, because don't forget the ultimate recovery, the ultimate formula for making gains. It's stress plus recovery equals adaptation. Listen carefully. Stress plus recovery equals adaptation. Stress plus no recovery, or stress plus stress, doesn't equal adaptation. Okay, so when do you get better? You get better, your muscles, when your muscles recover and your nervous system has recovered. That's when you get your gains. So when you sleep and rest and nap, you wake up, your body's literally transformed itself. Now, I believe you can actually get better live on the mat because you had an epiphany or you finally understood certain mechanics or you understood certain sequences. That's very cerebral. So cerebral, and when it comes to the mind can get better right now. When it comes to the body needs to go through a healing process. And that healing process is happening when you're sleeping. So don't skimp out on your sleep. This is from Mitch. I love MMA, trained for years, but I'm terrified of brain damage. CTE, how do I consolidate these thoughts? Well, Mitch, I would tell you, I hope I don't sound like a guy with CTE. And I do MMA every day. Every single day I do grappling, wrestling, or striking. Every single day of my life, except Sunday. And often Sundays I run a practice. I don't think I have CTE. I hope I don't sound like it. And here's why. Because when I train sensibly. I'm not training for a fight. Okay, so if I was fighting, I would have like 6 weeks of heart sparring. And that's enough. You save the brain cells for another day. When I'm sparring throughout the year, it's just friendly, playful stuff. Like I learned that from the Thais. You know, it's a great lesson. Arguably the greatest striker I ever worked with. One of the greatest strikers, I should say. Because I've had the privilege of working with so many great strikers. I don't want to signal any out. But so many of them just play spar. It's just great. Like Raymond Daniels can hit you with a back kick. No joke. In the first 20 seconds of a fight. So if the bell rings, ding, 20 seconds. Within, let's say within 20 to 60 seconds, he's back kicking you. Full power. Now, I'm talking about in a fight. In sparring, though, he'll just give you a little. He's the sweetest sparring guy, sparring partner you ever have. Like I've sparred with him myself. He's the last guy who's gonna hurt me, not because he couldn't, but because he's the best training partner, man. I saw him and George spar, and they spar for hours, man, just playing around, just trying to tag each other full speed, and they stop it right before they touch you. It's amazing what seasoned fighters do. You know, they get so much practice in without hurting each other, and they have this respect for one another. And they're gonna pull on their strikes, and they get world class skill. Plus, they're healthy. So, why would you train another way? Now, I'll tell you a quick story. I won't mention names. There was this one professional fighter sparring with another professional fighter. Not happening in my gym. This is not happening in my gym. One professional fighter is an elite striker, like a killer striker. And he's fighting this MMA guy. Okay, a really good MMA guy. I won't say more than that, but he was a top five guy. And they're sparring, and the striker was going light with him. He's just touching him and pop, 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 and touching him up. But he wasn't like cracking him. And the striker, the professional striker, the world-class striker was way ahead, way better. The MMA guy was getting furious, like, hey, man, I'm a pro, you're a pro, let's go for real, man, let's go for real, let's do this. We're like, well, okay, but, you know, like, we're trying to be nice, and we just, you know, it was the first time we sparred together, like, you know, the striker guy, the striker pro was like, I don't really want to hit you, you know, like, I don't think it's a smart strategy, let's just spar, you know, friendly. No, no, let's do this, man, you're a pro, I'm a pro, let's do this. Okay, so they went at it. The striker, and don't forget, they weren't doing MMA sparring, they were doing striking sparring. So we're the striker, the pro striker, knocks out the pro MMA guy, knocks him out. And we're like, man, that guy was asking for it, he was begging for it. Well, he gave it to him. And it didn't make him any better. The MMA guy didn't get anything positive out of that. Now he's going towards the CTE world, and he's the one, he should have been wise. This older, wiser, more skilled striker is telling him, look, it's not the right way. Beating each other up doesn't make any sense. Anyways, long story short, I think he might have learned a lesson that day. Okay, I got a few super chats I got to do here. This is from Sufi Mir. What makes the difference between a GSP elite fighter like an elite fighter like Rory? Much love. You know what, it's complicated. You know, George started competing since he started training at the age of 5, and he's the type of guy, he's took really good care of his body. So for many years, even though he trained for so many years for so many hours, he was always very careful with keeping his body healthy. And for some reason, he never lost he was always in the gym. Like George was in the gym 24 hours a day, all day long, and still to this day. So he's just a guy who's just totally obsessed with training all the time. What people say about Hickson seems humanly impossible. What is the limit of human potential? What was the secret behind his godly grappling. Well, listen, Varum, I wouldn't say he's a godly grappler. Okay, let's not take it that far. It's true that many great grapplers, elite world champions, trained with Hicks and Gracie. And they all unanimously say he's the best, and they got their ass kicked from him. And don't forget, this is years ago when Hickson was in his prime. He would invite world-class black belts over to his gym, and they would all say, Hickson's the man. Why? Well, don't forget, he started training at a high level at a young age, all day, all night long. His father was Elio Gracie. His cousin was Halls Gracie, arguably the greatest Gracie of all time. Arguably. There's so many great Gracies. He was training elite level since the day he could walk. His father started him and his father and his uncle together. These guys were the cutting edge of jiu-jitsu. And this is the first generation being born in the Gracie clan. Not obviously Elio was born as a Gracie, obviously, but he wasn't born in a jiu-jitsu family. Elio and his brother Carlos Gracie started this jiu-jitsu phenomenon. Now this is the first generation being born as Gracies in the grappling family. So to them, grappling was like walking, swimming, eating, I assume, you know, because I mean, I've watched their documentaries. These guys were deep in the game from a young age. So by the time everybody caught up, you know, he looks like he's unbeatable to you. But the truth of the matter is, jiu-jitsu is bigger than any man. Guys, don't forget, jiu-jitsu is bigger. If you can bring me a world champion from 10 years ago and put him on the mats today, it might not go well for him. Especially with the leg locks and all that, okay? In their time, it's like taking a wrestler from 100 years ago. They might not be as good as today, because today we have wrestling programs and we have wrestling this. And now, you know, we've refined the technique. The techniques have been refined. The teaching methods, the training methods. No man is bigger than jiu-jitsu itself. So I don't want to go that far. In his time, he was shoulders and head above. And we have to respect that, you know, because he got to that level. That's something very special. DBK69, new member. Well, welcome, my friend. Welcome to the clan. All right, my friends. Okay, let's see here. Hey, what is your advice on managing university, MMA, and part-time job? That's from Huseifa. Huseifa, you're bringing me back because I suffered greatly doing those three things. When I was going to university, I was training full-time. I was training professionals. I was competing as an amateur. And I had a job. My goodness. Wow. I'm telling you, I used to burn the candles at both ends. It was crazy. I would literally miss a night of sleep every week because I would finish the night shift late at night and work the next morning. Or like, it was just nuts. I would study through the night. Like, it was just insane what I would do. And I would wake up early and train, go to school, then go to the gym, then come back home late, do whatever I have to do for school, go back to bed. Between classes, writing papers, managing, and just being crazy. Trying to get ahead. I was totally insane. It was so wrong what I did. What happened? I was at work one day. I used to work the night shift at a gas station. I used to pump gas, believe it or not. And I was sitting there in the gas station. I got like this headache. Boom. A headache in my head, boom, and a pain in my eye, and all of a sudden I can't look at light no more. If there's a light, I can't look at it. And I went to the doctors. They're telling me I had a burnout, they call it an onset headache. And I was like, for 2 weeks I was locked in my basement. I couldn't look at light. I was like, everything was, if somebody dropped a pin on the other side of the room, it would make me feel like somebody hit my head with a hammer. Like, it was so bad. I was in such a horrible, uncomfortable, irritable state. Like, everything was hurting, everything was making me everything was too overwhelming. Like, it was incredibly difficult for me. I ended up losing time. I thought I was making time. I ended up losing time. I didn't get back to normal for years. Listen carefully to me, for you young guys trying to do too much. I wasn't normal again for years. Like right now, I would consider myself very healthy. This happened to me when I was like 18, 19, maybe 20. Okay, a little bit before 20 years old. I would tell you now that maybe 21 even, actually, if I'm going to think about it. Right now, let's say it was about 20 years ago. I feel better. But for 10 years, it took me about 10 years that if I had a bad night's sleep, the next day I couldn't function. That's how important sleep became. Sleep became like super important for me. I learned my lesson after that. I had to reduce my course load after. I did a lot of things. I started basically taking two classes a semester. I was like, you know what? I'll finish school slowly. I did finish school, but I took my time after that. Because, you know, I wanted to finish quick. I wanted to get my master's. I wanted to get a PhD. In my mind, I had to get a PhD. It has to be PhD. PhD or bust. And then I realized, hey, no. Am I a professional trainer? Am I a professional fighter? Am I a scholar? Like, where am I going? You know, I can't go all three. So I started cutting. You know, I started saying, look, I'm going to not do fights anymore. I did more fights, but once in a while. And I was training more and more pros because my pros were winning. So I had to get more pros and more pros were winning and more pros. And all of a sudden I have more pros than I can handle. And I have more students than I can handle. So I decided, hey, you know what? What am I doing in my life? Okay, I'm a trainer. I'm going to finish my BA and then I'm going to go back into training. Because that's what I love the most. From all the three, that's what I love the most. Okay. If in the future I get old and I can't be a trainer no more, I'll go get my master's and my PhD. Then I'll have time to do it. But when I was trying to do all three at once, I'm telling you something. I was digging my own grave. And I remember my father sitting me down and saying, hey, you know, you got to think about what you're doing. You're doing too many things. And I was like, no, don't worry. I'm in shape. I can handle it. It's not hard for me. It's very easy. And guess what? One day my body called me on it. I had an onset headache, shut me down. From then out, for like 2 weeks, I was sleeping 14, 15 hours a day. I would just wake up to eat and go back to bed. I would do another 8 hours. It was insane how much I suffered, how uncomfortable I felt. I destroyed my nervous system. And I had to rebuild slowly, get back in the game, but so many things were different. And if I missed 1 hour of sleep, I felt it. My body was like on a strict regimen. Do not mess with me. When it's time to sleep, you better sleep. I changed my schedule. I made a little less money. I competed a little less. I cut from here. I cut from there. I reduced my workload, my class load, and eventually I caught back up. But that's the curse of trying to do too much. So be very careful with that. Okay, gentlemen. Let's see what else we have here. Been training hard every day, but sometimes can't fall asleep even when taking melatonin. That's from Macro Bella 92. I'll tell you what I do to fall asleep. I'm a fall asleep master. I put on an audiobook. I put on my headphones, plug in my phone, audiobook, something really interesting. Get on audible.com, find like 5, 6, 7 interesting books. And when you're listening to one, if you really get into it, you'll doze off. If it's boring and you're going to start thinking in your head, you got to get something interesting, man. That's the secret. Something interesting. You lie down in bed. You listen to it. You'll turn your mind off. Your mind will turn off and you'll... Or listen to this podcast. That's another interesting thing you could listen to. Just find something distracting. And if it's not working, something's bothering you. There's something in your life that's stressing with you. And you got to attack that head on. Solve that problem. Your body doesn't let you sleep because it feels there's an imminent threat somewhere in your environment. There's something you must deal with. It's time to put all your energy in dealing with that problem. Okay, Fabian has a super chat. And I am back, coach. So what is your best submission and why? And what is the least favorite submission to get caught in? That's from Fabian Antoine. Fabian, my favorite submission. That's so hard. Like if I was in a fight to the death and you told me, look, you're going in a fight to the death and you can only pick one sub. You know, you're going to fight this guy to the death and there's only one sub we're allowing you to do. I would pick rear naked choke.
because I would be really strategic about it. I'd be taking this fight deep, like 5 hours deep. Like, if you tell me I can't miss, I have to beat this guy. Oh, this is going to be a long fight. I'm going to take him deep. I'm going to learn everything about him. Then I'm going to put that rear naked choke when he least expects it. But I do, if you give me 3 5-minute rounds and you got to sub this guy, guillotine. Give me the guillotine. I'm going to put him in a guillotine. One way or another, I'm going to find my way to wrap his neck and I'm going to make him tap. Leg lock would be a third option. Leg lock, I love. My least favorite thing to get caught in. Eesh. Everything. Every sub I hate getting caught in. But if I had to pick one, I'll probably say guillotine. Guillotine's annoying. Yeah, because, you know, you didn't have to take me down. You didn't have to mount me. You didn't have to take my back. Like, you know, like, I hate shooting on a guy and getting guillotine. I hate that. It's like, it's such a frustrating thing. Jose Reyes, what is your thought on cutting weight for BJJ comp? Much love. You're an inspiration. Thank you. Well, Jose, thank you very much, my friend. What are my thoughts? You know, I think it shouldn't be exaggerated because the match is the same day. So I think they should allow you a certain amount of weight to cut. So I'd say 5 to 10 pounds. And they should weigh you before your match to make sure you didn't do anything ridiculous. It's something, it should be fair. You know, the whole spirit of the weigh-in is that two guys of the same size are competing against one another. So if some guy's doing some crazy cuts or he can have a 20-pound weight advantage, this has nothing to do with jiu-jitsu. Like, this is just not a fair, there's no point in having a weigh-in. This guy's, he's doing all these crazy tricks to bypass the weigh-in because he just doesn't want to learn how to get good at jiu-jitsu. His ticket to winning is being bigger than the other guy. Well, that's just defeating the whole spirit of the event, you know. I sent a super chat before, you haven't read it. That's from Alex Heaton. Alex, my friend, my dear friend Alex Heaton. Let me see if I can find you, please, Mr. Heaton. Okay, let's see here. Mr. Heaton. No, I did miss some super chats. Now I'm seeing. Now you put me in a snowball here. Okay, Mr. Heaton, why don't you post your question again just in the chat? I'm going to give you a couple of seconds to do it, Mr. Heaton. Mr. Alex Heaton, pop your question right now. I'm waiting for you. While I do that, I'll answer a few more. Coach, my wife got me the Tim Tam for my birthday. It's a game changer. Thanks for the recommendation. That's from Azmi. Azmi, congratulations. You have the best wife. Tell her she's the best. Coach says she's the best because that was a great gift for her husband. Congratulations on your Tim Tam. I hope you enjoy it, my friend. All right, who else? What else we got? Why is everyone in BJJ competition on roids? I want to compete but not get injured. That's from Adam Paul. That's such a great comment. You know, there are so many guys going like these local tournaments. They're all roided up. Like, it's like, dude, man, like, do you really need to be roided up to win a local competition? This is not the sport for you. Like, even the guys, like, I get it. At the highest level, there's so much of that. Like, I don't want to say no and stand here like a hypocrite. No, no, nobody does anything. No, there's a lot of people who do a lot of things, highest level. Okay, I hate to say it. Not the coach, though. If you guys want to coach to pee in the cup, any day of the week, I don't think nobody's gonna accuse me of doing steroids, but you know what I'm saying here. You guys understand what I'm trying to say. But at a local tournament, you should win a handful of local tournaments at least. You know, you should get, you know, really good at jiu-jitsu because you're never going to have... I'll never trust your jiu-jitsu. If you started with... I never trust you understand what jiu-jitsu is. If you did jiu-jitsu and started roiding up before you got a purple belt, I don't think you understand jiu-jitsu. You think you understand jiu-jitsu. You talk about jiu-jitsu. You talk about this arm bar and that arm bar and this choke. But you still don't understand what jiu-jitsu is about, my friend. And you shouldn't be teaching jiu-jitsu because what you're teaching, you can't teach to a human being. Because you can't teach a regular Joe. That your jiu-jitsu doesn't work. I've seen so many guys have an effective jiu-jitsu, but it's not real jiu-jitsu. Don't confuse effectiveness with efficiency. It's effective because the guy's he's got the strength of two men, three men, but it ain't efficient. Those are two different things. I don't think I need to explain it. I think you guys are understanding what I'm saying. Okay. Coach Zahabi, I'm a former white belt. Very good. I'm impervious to leg locks. My calves are super sane strong. Do you know anyone in the world like that? That's from Cookie. Cookie, do me a favor. Come to TriStar Gym. Let me slap a couple of leg locks on you and let me see how strong those calves hold up, Mr. Cookie Calves. This is from Mr. Cookie Calves.
dude, I want you to come and try Star Gym and say, hey, coach, I'm Kooky Calves. We don't have to say anything more. We'll look at each other and be like, you're Kooky Calves? Yeah. The bell's going to ring and we're going to go. And we'll see. If your calves can hold up, man, I'm going to start doing your calf, whatever your calf routine is, I'm going to do it. And if you want, I'll promote it to the mass. I'll be like, hey guys, Kooky Calves, man. You try to leg lock this guy, his calves ain't having it. But come on down first. Gemini June, for us, how does alcohol affect your training? My training partners love drinking. Do you think too much whiskey affected Connor somewhat against Khabib? That's from Gemini June. Gemini, I definitely think if you drink and you go to training, you could ruin your career. I've personally heard of guys. I know one very good trainer, who's a very dear friend of mine, who's a world-class trainer. I don't want to mention his name because I don't want to name the fighter. But he told me he had a fighter coming in the gym drunk. Now, I never had that. And I've had guys go out, get drunk, and call in sick, or not show up, or come up the next day and not have a great day. But he told me he had this one fighter who was training, during training camp, was drunk. He would come to the gym smelling like alcohol. Now, this guy had a very promising career, and all of a sudden, he couldn't let go of these drinks. I don't know why. I have no idea. And he was telling me, because I used to ask him, what happened to this so-and-so? This guy had a lot of promise. Oh, he could come to the gym and he was drunk. He had alcohol before coming to training. We'd smell it on him. I'm like, really? Yeah, he ruined his career with alcohol. Now, I'm sure your friends are not coming to the gym drunk, but I've heard stories of guys ruining their careers, professional fighters, ruining their careers because they couldn't let go of drinking. I've heard you speak about perfection argumentation. Can you define perfection? Flawless being or best conceivable being? And could you explain why you can't add or take away from it? That's from Alex Heaton. Wow, Alex, you just took this conversation on a turn. Alex is asking about the idea of perfection. What is this idea? We have this idea of perfection. How do we know it exists? Does it exist out there in the world? Well, Mr. Alex, think about it. You're asking me, explain why you can't add or take away from it. Think about this, Mr. Heaton. If it's perfect, think about it. If you're hanging a picture, I tell you, oh, a little bit more to the right, a little bit more to the left. Stop! It's perfect. But if it's perfect, why would you keep it? After I tell you it's perfect, why would you adjust it? If it's perfect by definition, adding or taking away is not necessary. Hence, it's perfect. If something is perfect and I have to add to it, it wasn't perfect. Adding to it won't make it any better. Perfection, by definition, entails that we don't need to add or take away. That is what the word perfect means. Sometimes we lose track of things. We always have to remind ourselves, so what's the essence of the word? The essence of the word perfection, meaning adding and taking away, would be detrimental. Or actually, if you think about it, impossible. Think about it, Alex. If it's truly perfect, I couldn't mess with it. Now, the frame example is a poor example because I'm taking two ideas, as Hume would say, I'm taking two impressions and creating a new idea. So I'm taking the idea of frame and the idea of perfection, and I'm trying to reflect them together. I'm mixing these two ideas, but these two ideas exist independently. So perfection exists on its own. If it didn't exist, I couldn't know about it. If you ever read Descartes' Meditations, Descartes goes through a very interesting description in his meditations. He says, look, you can never draw or think of something original. Suppose you think about the marshmallow man, a 50-foot marshmallow man. Well, he would say, look, this is not the example he uses in his book. I just made that one up. I'm thinking of Ghostbusters for some reason. You take the idea of marshmallow, you took the idea of man, you put them together. You saw something of 50 feet once upon a time, maybe a hill or something, and you put that, you added that height, you have that augmentation, as Hume would say. You augmented it. Somebody poured you a glass of water and you witnessed augmentation for the first time. So you put that in the mix, you put that impression in the mix. But what Hume would tell you is, said, look, you never knew what a marshmallow is until somebody presented you one. You never knew what a man was until you came up, were born in this world and you met a human being. And you never knew what augmentation was until somebody once poured a drink for you, or any other type of augmentation. Anything, could be anything, okay? Maybe when you were a kid, you saw somebody stack bricks one on top of another and you witnessed augmentation for the first time. But you could never, a human mind could never deduce augmentation on their own. They have to experience these things. For more on this, if you want to read the Book of Phaedo by Plato, it's one of my favorite books. Check it out. Phaedo. The Book of Phaedo. It's an interesting book. Okay, my dear friends. This is from Fabian. What was it like being there that night when Robbie Lawler and Rory McDonald had their super fight? What was your reaction, you think, etc.? Adrenaline must have been insane. Fabian, yes, look, I don't like talk about my fighters, but that was an old fight. I'll just give you a quick rundown. Because it was a past fight, so it's not so bad. Listen, it was a phenomenal fight. Rory was ahead on the scorecards at all cards. So he had round one on the scorecard. He had round three and four. He hurt Robbie, and Robbie got saved by the bell at one point. So Robbie had Robbie days and saved by the bell. It was seesaw battle in those rounds. Three and four was seesaw, but Rory took him. Round one was Rory's. Round two, the judges gave it to Lawler, so it was 3-1. All he had to do was survive round five, but he had a badly broken nose. That's the truth. You know, he had a badly broken nose. He had an injured nose. He's broken his nose a few times, and you know, I don't want to talk too much about that, but he had a bad nose. Luckily, now it's been years. It's been fixed. He's seen the best guys. He took the time off to heal. When he was younger, he didn't want to take time off to heal when he hurt his nose in practice and this and that. He just, oh no, I'm going to do what I'm going to do. And he was young, and you know, these are opportunities you can't give up. But nowadays, he knows that he's got to take care of his body, and he's back to it. You know, once the coronavirus thing is over, he'll be back in there. Okay, my friends, we are 1 hour deep in this podcast. I'm hoping you guys liked it. I'm hoping you guys are enjoying it and pushing that like button, you know, and, you know, giving me the likes I need. How do I keep my promise? I keep falling into the same sin over and over again. I want to change for good. That's from Adam Paul. Adam Paul, I don't know what sin. This is not confessional here. My dear friend, you know, I wish I could hear your juicy sins, but I'm assuming it's you're breaking one of the Ten Commandments, so keep it to yourself. I'm sure it's a big one. It sounds like it's a really big one you're breaking. Listen, I think you need some time and solitude and reflect on your actions, my friend. Where else we got here? Guys, please don't ask me about fighters and fights coming up because I can't really talk about these things on the podcast. We need a moderator. We did not get a moderator. Are you going to make more content with Silver Fox? Absolutely. That's from Mr. Steezy. Absolutely. But unfortunately, coronavirus rears its ugly head. Border is closed. Unfortunately. Listen, guys, I don't want to go on another rampage, on another rant on coronavirus. Okay, so let's try to avoid that one because I'm really getting fed up of being quarantined. Super chats are asking to deal with BJJ anxiety, competition, and doubt. Thank you. Guys, I've done that question so many times, I'm going to skip it today. My apologies, but I don't want to bore the guys who are regulars. Well, we will pick it up another day. Did I like movie Gladiator? That's from CSS. I think you're asking if I like the movie Gladiator. Yes, I did. That was a cool movie. The one with the Russell Crowe, it was good. All right, we got a $23 super chat. This is unbelievable. Alex Heaton. Oh my God. Oh no, it's the same old question. My fault. Okay, here's a new one. This is from Bang Bubba. As a philosopher, what is your philosophy on hallucinogen? Tony Robbins and Mike Tyson and Mike's podcast talk about their experience with the toad and saw God. What is your take and experience? That's from Bang Bubba. All right, my friend, dear Bang Bubba, I think we're going to end this on this. Actually, there's more super chats coming in. Okay. Let's talk about something, okay? There are levels. There are mind shifts. A human being can have a mind shift. A human being can go through different altered states. Now, a lot of you out here are young, and you've been in altered states in your mind, but you have been in altered states when you were unconscious, when you were sleeping, so you don't recall them. But I guarantee you, every human being has been in altered state, because altered states start in the womb. Your mind is not like it was now. Your mind is not like it is now. Your mind is not like it was in the womb. Your mind has changed, obviously. So by definition, your mind has altered. There are certain things I could tell you that you will receive and understand very differently depending on what state of mind you are in. Now, what I'm telling you right now is, for those of you who are listening, is going to creep back up into your mind in the future. Forget about it now. Well, you just might be listening and be like, Coach, what are you talking about? Well, my young friends, many of you, I'm much older than you all. I promise you that if you pay close attention, you will catch yourself in multiple states of mind. Now, ironically enough, is you have to be mindful of it. Try to observe your mind as a third person and notice what state of mind you are in. In philosophy, we have levels of skepticism. Science, the scientific method, I'm using the term science in today's popular term, it's not the way it's been used throughout history. In philosophy, that is the lowest, and I'm not saying this is a put down at all. I'm not saying it as a put down at all, okay? Philosophy, we love science. Philosophers love science. But it is the lowest level of skepticism, not the highest. People walk around saying, I love science, I'm a science guy, science is my religion, and they think they're at the top. Dude, that's the lowest level. That just gets you into the conversation. That's it. If you understand the scientific method, you can come and sit with us. There are higher levels, so you can go a little bit higher. Let's go a little bit higher. Let's go to the Thomas Kuhn. Thomas Kuhn says, look, I trust science, but science isn't perfect. He starts to critique science. He wrote Scientific Revolution. Controversial book, but any philosopher of science will admit to what he writes. Any philosopher of science. Some guy learned the scientific method and he thinks he learned everything. He's wrong. He has to become a philosopher of science. He has to understand how that method came to be and why do we use this method. And above all, he has to understand what is the definition of true. So you have to go higher. Thomas Kuhn, he didn't get to definition of true. No, he's not there yet. Thomas Kuhn's just now doubting this super strong pragmatic method that we have, that we love so much, to change the world. So we have Thomas Kuhn. Then we're going to go even higher. We're going to go to a David Hume. David Hume just doesn't trust anybody, anything. Then we go even harder. We go to a Cartesian doubt. Cartesian, David, René Descartes / Imam Ghazali. They want to know even, how do you know I'm not dreaming right now? I'm going to get back to your question. I promise this is all relevant. I promise you. Ghazali and Descartes, Ghazali asked it first, let's be fair. He said, I want to know, how do I know I'm not in a dream state? And I want to be fair, even in the sages of China, they said it. How do I know that? I woke up and I was dreaming I was a butterfly. Then I realized, I don't know, maybe I'm a butterfly waking up dreaming I'm a man. I don't know which one it is. Am I a man dreaming I'm a butterfly? Am I a butterfly dreaming a man? Now, this is too high for 99.9% of people. They never get this far. And if you brought them down this road, they would reject it emotionally. They would have no logical reason to reject. They would do so emotionally through some kind of primitive reaction. Some dislike of this kind of talk because you're rocking their beliefs. You're rocking their foundation. So we have this skepticism, this critical thinking. 1% of the world goes to college. They learn about critical thinking. That's the statistic, guys. I'm not making it up. 1% of the world starts to this level of critical thinking that's called a scientific level of thinking. We want proof. We want evidence. We want tests. We want experiments. Then we go higher. We have the scientific revolution. We have Thomas Kuhn. Then we go higher. We have David Hume. Then we go higher. We have Ghazali. We have Descartes. And then we go higher. And we have nothing left. Because don't forget, when Descartes wrote his meditation, they called it, this is a modern philosophy. This is the highest level of skepticism, even though it was done in the past. Even though it was done in the past in different cultures, it was done in the past. People asked, how do you know you're not dreaming? Way before in the past. Okay, how do you know you're not in a matrix? How do you know I'm not in a spaceship right now? Okay, these are hard to answer questions. Okay, these are deep questions. And then we have the definition of truth. Remember, we said we have to define what is true, and there are many definitions, and they all fall short. 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 Give me any definition that anybody's ever come with, from Plato to Kant, and we could poke a hole in each one of them. And I'm not talking about me. I'm talking about philosophers have poked holes in every definition, save one. The Ghazalian definition, or the Cartesian definition, I could say. They want to have no doubt. Something is true when there is no possible way to doubt it. Okay, I should also mention Avicenna, because Avicenna said it best. Okay? It should have absolutely no way to doubt. So all these philosophers, every time we presented them a new theory of what is true, what is it, what does it mean for something to be true? And I love pointing to Sam Harris versus Peterson when they met and they had a podcast on what is true and they couldn't agree. And it was interesting. One thing I should do, guys, if this video gets 1,000 likes, I will do a podcast, a reaction video to that conversation. That way I'll know that I'm not hurting people out there who are coming here for MMA. If you guys want to hear me do a reaction video of any kind, put it in the description. But one I would like to do, I'm just throwing it out there, I'm throwing it in the hat, is I would like to play that video. We could listen to it together and I can help kind of break it down. What are they saying? Why are they saying this? And, you know, what's my opinion on it? If you guys are interested in hearing it, get this video to 1,000 likes and I will be compelled. I'll have no choice. I'll give you my word. I'll do it. But I'll tell you something. The one definition of truth that I live by personally, and I'll accept something as true, but not true with a capital T, it has to have zero doubt. Zero doubt. Now listen to this, okay? This is why I love Ghazali. He's my favorite thinker. He said, look, I need to have this. This is how serious I am, guys. If you tell me something is true, I have to have no doubt. Ghazali says, listen to what he says, beautiful. He says, if you see an arrow flying towards a target, you have no right to say that arrow is going to hit. Think about it. An arrow rushing towards a target. What speed is it rushing? I don't know. 100 feet per second? Like something crazy, something psychotic. Okay, not 100 feet per second, but you get what I'm saying. It's blindingly fast. He's saying if you see it flowing through the air, you have no right to say it's going to hit that target. And the reason why he says that is brilliant. You guys are probably thinking, oh, no, it makes no sense. No, it makes total sense for philosophers. If you're hearing this and you're a philosopher, you're poorly, and you don't agree, you're poorly trained. If you understand, God bless you, you're the 1%. He's saying, look, anyways, I'm not going to get into it. It has to do with the problem of causation. He's saying something so brilliant. We're talking about like an epic level of understanding. And he's saying, look, I need to know something with complete certainty. 100%. And that level of thinking, it brings you to something called, and I'm getting back to your question, I promise you, I haven't forgot Bang Baba. Believe me, I did this whole turn just for you, Mr. Bang. All of this is for you. He said, look, you get to this level where everything is doubtable. Everything. Everything has doubt. Everything has doubt. Everything has doubt. Except this one last thing. This one last, everything is melted away. Even my own self, like for instance, you know, we can't even say what a person is. Like if you try to define the essence of a person, now what is the essence? Let's define essence, okay? If I change, what is the essence of something? If I change the essence, I change the thing. So if this chair has an essence, what's a chair? Oh, a chair is a platform you can sit on with four legs. Well, what about this chair? It has only three legs. They do exist. Three-legged chairs exist. Oh yeah, you're right. Okay, it doesn't have to have four legs. It can have from one to three legs. Well, what about this chair? It has no legs. It's kind of off the wall. You know, it's bolted into the wall. Okay, it has to be a surface you sit on, designed for sitting, legs irrelevant, with or without legs. Okay, that's the essence of a chair. Let's say we narrow it down to that. If I change anything of that, if I have a platform now and it's not made for sitting, no longer a chair. You've changed the essence, you've changed chair. So the essence of a chair is not four legs, because I can change one leg. I can have a three-legged chair. Think of like a bar stool or something. And it's still a chair. Okay, so essence cannot be reliant on four legs. So we create these definitions, these essences, and we cannot deny them. Okay, so a great example that Aristotle gave us. He said, look, if you look at 100 knives, each one of those knives has one thing in common. That's their essence. Whatever that one thing is, it's not easy to nail down, guys. Believe me, it's really tough. All of Plato is, I should say most of Plato is trying to nail down what an essence is of various things. And we just, at the end of the book, we're like, hey, we're not sure. For the vast majority of the attempts Plato goes for, okay? And when we try to give the essence of what a human being is, it is very difficult. I'm not going to go down that road because that's going to be a tangent for another day. We're going to talk about what is the essence of a human being. What makes a human being a human? Like if you built a machine that's exactly like me, a robot. It's got eyes for cameras. It's got a brain for a computer. It's got a computer for a brain, I should say. It's got sheet metal for skin. It's got oil for blood. It's got a pump for a heart. It doesn't have a flesh heart. But it's exactly like me. It's designed like me. It talks like it does everything. But you wouldn't say it's human. Why? What's the difference? Well, it's missing something. So anyways, we'll put that on the side for another day. That's an interesting topic for another day. But the skeptic will go so far, he'll reach a level we call mysticism. That's the truth. People hate to admit this. They hate hearing it. I don't know why. Don't ask if you don't want to know. But mysticism is the highest level of skepticism. This is where you only accept one thing. There's only one thing left, okay? And it has to do with God, okay? A lot of people are not going to like me to say this. But these men that are taking these drugs, and I don't recommend you do that. You can get there naturally. These men who are taking these drugs, what I've noticed, that sometimes they say or write things down that a mystic would write or say. Now, when I read the writings of a mystic, I could tell you that I understand to a certain degree what they're trying to say. And to another person, he doesn't understand anything. Like, he's like, that's just babbling. I don't hear babbling. I hear something very profound. However, I've also seen, I was funny because I was talking to my wife about this the other day. We're watching a long time ago, we were watching a show about intervention, and this girl was like so in the drugs. So I'm telling you, I don't even want to describe it, how bad it was. And they were showing you some of the things she wrote, some of the graffiti, and it was very profound stuff. Why? Because when you go into drugs, I wouldn't know, but I'm assuming, you go into an altered state where you see things completely different. What seems rational to you now, and what seems irrational to you now in this state of mind, is completely different when you're in that altered state. What once seemed irrational makes total sense. This is what's scary about altered states. And what seemed rational makes no sense to us now in this new altered mind. Sometimes somebody says something, and because you're in a particular state of mind, it sounds ridiculous or profound. The human mind, the way you're, whatever state of mind you're in, can dramatically affect how you perceive the world around you or new information coming in. There is a particular state of mind, gentlemen, if you're listening, where everything is vapor and there's only one thing left. Everything else is vapor. Everything is vapor. Everything can be doubted except this one thing, this one last thing that if you try to doubt it, you'd be proving it. Think about it. Can you doubt that you're doubting? Some people tell me, I doubt everything. Can you doubt that you're doubting? You can't doubt that you're doubting. If you doubt that you're doubting, then you're proving that you're, it's like, it's a paradox. So you can never say, I believe in nothing. And you can never say, I doubt everything. Because then you'd have to doubt that you're doubting. That means that you subconsciously believe. You have a doubt that you actually think that you might know something. So we come to this paradox, but it's a lived paradox. That's all I could say. The toad, you lick a toad and you get high and you see all these freaky things. I think personally, it gets you in that altered state of mind. It forces you in that altered state of mind. Even though you're not a philosopher, even though you didn't climb that ladder. What I'm trying to say is human beings climb that ladder. They go from skeptic to ultra skeptic till there's one last thing they can't doubt. A very interesting book written on this is The Niche of Lights by none other than Ghazali. Nobody's ever written it down. In my opinion, from all the books I've read, nobody ever got as far. Descartes came close, and in my opinion, Descartes read Ghazali 100% because some of the things are very extremely similar. Let's not forget, Ghazali wrote 600 years before. And Descartes kind of slips up. He says, listen to what he says. He says, I think, therefore I am. I think, I, me. Then Nietzsche comes back later on and says, look, the I is a presupposition. A discussion for another day, guys, because we're an hour 24 minutes deep. But I think is a presupposition. You haven't proved the I. What is the I? Who is this I? And we try to find the essence of a human being. It slips out of our hands. It turns out that it's nothing but vapor. The human conception of who we are. I wouldn't like to use the term vapor. I would say it's information. Human beings are a type of information. Now, really interesting because we've had these discussions for thousands of years. If you read the literature, like for instance, if you look at Pythagoras. Pythagoras, he believed that everything is number. What is number? Number is information. He totally disagreed with Democritus. Democritus thought there was only atoms and the void. There's this thing called an atom. Another discussion for another day. We'll talk about the atom one day. We'll do a whole episode on the history of the atom. The atom and the void. There's these building blocks bouncing around in the universe, and that's all there is. And then Pythagoras says, no, that's just an illusion. What's behind those atoms is information, numbers. Those atoms are a byproduct of the mind, and the mind only understands numbers. There's no actual atom out there. Fast forward 2,500 years later, Heisenberg and Schopenhauer. Schopenhauer saying an atom is like a, almost like, you know those drawings they give you of an atom. It's like a, like one body orbiting another. You know that drawing they give you an atom. And Heisenberg is like, no, atoms are unknowable. They're information. They're akin to mathematical equations. That's all they are. Similar conversation, not identical. I'm not going to say it's identical. But look, 2,500 years later, so it's in our modern day, we're still having these debates. Is the world vapor, information? Plato says the world is vapor. It's information. Aristotle, another great two opposing schools of thought. Okay, these opposing schools of thought can be found generation after generation. Aristotle, look, the world is biology. The world is nuts and bolts. Then you have all this mind stuff. Plato's like, no, the whole world is mind. Then you have these nuts and bolts. And these nuts and bolts, they're really just mind. You have idealism all the way up to Leibniz. All the way up through all the ages till today. We still have prominent philosophers that are idealist versus materialist versus dualists. A talk for another day. Very interesting and profound stuff. Fun stuff to talk about that I like to do only deep in the show, guys. First, we talk about fitness, fighting, and all that stuff. And then for the diehards who are still around, we could talk about anything, absolutely anything you want. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. And look, I will promise to keep my word. If this video gets 1,000 likes, I said I was going to do a video. I'm going to do a reaction video to Sam Harris and Peterson, because I listened to it. And I could tell you something that I feel I could add to the conversation. I would love to sit down and talk to one of those guys one day for fun. And I think we can have a very fun and interesting, exciting conversation for you guys. And as well, I will be willing, I'm more than happy to learn as always and share any information I have. Now, with that said, guys, if you want to see me do any reaction video, give me some good ideas, you know, to keep this channel fun for you guys. Give me any ideas on any reaction video you want. I'm looking forward to doing it because after playing that video today, I feel like I could talk, I could watch and talk. I know how to push the buttons now. So in the future, I could set up any reaction video and we can add a new dimension to this channel. And any cool video you guys see, put it in the comments, send it to me on this episode. Say, Coach, check out this video. You have to do a reaction video to this. And if it gets a lot of likes in the comments and I see it up there, I'm going to do it. Okay, guys, thank you for tuning in. I appreciate you all. Make sure to like, share, and subscribe. And I will see you all in the next episode. Thank you very much.